Welcome, everyone, to Music Junkies, a podcast about people sharing extraordinary stories about how music has impacted their lives.
Welcome, everyone, to Music Junkies. I'm your host, Annette Smith, and our guest today, I'm so excited, is award-winning songwriter and producer. He sold over 67 million records worldwide. Unreal. Has written and produced songs for Falco, Status Quo, Samantha Fox, Barclay, Roger Chapman, John Logan, and so many more. He was born in Port Elizabeth. My middle name is Elizabeth, which is really cool. From South Africa, started composing songs at an early age. He's extremely passionate and dedicated. His fascination for movies has had a great impact on his writing. He wrote Status Quo hit, The Army Now, Falco, Rock Me Amadeus, as everyone knows, is a great hit, smash hit, U.S. Billboard, international smash hit. Rob wrote songs specifically for the artist Falco. His work has been featured in numerous films, television series such as Netflix, Stranger Things, Adventureland, Disney's Bedtime Stories, Family Guy, and The Simpsons. He is a legend in the industry. Please welcome Rob Bollan to the show. Welcome, Rob. I'm so excited. Yeah, it's awesome.
Thank you, Nick. Thank
you are so welcome. So before I get started and kind of diving deep in your playlist, because you've had so much success and have wrote so many songs, what was your experience putting your playlist together for me today?
Well, that was kind of nice because I went back to my youth, and then I noticed that I had about 16 songs about, you know, from my youth. And it's, okay, we have to scale up a bit towards my age now, it was very nice and very hard to select those songs. I mean, it's for everybody. If you say, well, name your favorite song, I mean, each day or each moment of the day, it'll be a different song. And the same goes for me. You know, it was nice doing it. Yeah.
I think it's interesting that you said, you know, so many people that I interview do have, I think music is just born in our youth. Like, it's almost like when we think of songs, we go back to that time. And then it's so hard to like, oh, what did I listen to in my 20s? What did I listen to in my 30s? But I feel like most people's playlist is that 13 to 18 time.
Well, good that you mentioned it, because for me, it's a bit more towards my younger years. Even I was from the first moment, I think it was 5 or 6, I was really crazy about music, especially pop music again. And the lists, the charts. So, well, I was born in South Africa. I went to Holland, and so it was a bit moving around the family. But then we eventually landed in South Africa when I was around 6. And then there was a weekly broadcast of the. In South Africa, they had the Springbok radio, you know, that's the national, then you have television. And I wrote everything down, and it's a long, very long answer to a very, so you have to cut me off certain times because I keep going.
No, I love it. It's good.
So it was hard putting it together.
I have always been asked, hey, Annette, when are you going to get interviewed? And I like, oh my God, like to come, like I find my guests coming up with 10 songs is amazing. Like I find it so hard. I have, you know, I continue to add, and those songs bring up a memory, or it's so crazy. And I'm so inspired that my guests can actually come up with 10 songs. Cause I don't know if I could do it.
It's a very good formula because you get people to go to work and to have fun doing this, you know?
Yeah.
So much fun preparing the list. And I see on my list, I see on my list that I have, you say 10 songs, but I think I have about 20 on my list here. So I don't even know which I sent to you. So it'll be exciting for me to see which one has made this, you know.
That's good. All right, we're going to start with your first song. Are you ready?
Yeah. I am. Okay.
May as well dive right into it, right?
Falco, okay.
Rock Me Amadeus. How did this even come into fruition?
Yeah, well, it's nice that you start with this song because it's also, I mean, people don't know me. In Europe, you know, musicians and people who follow the charts know who I am. But in Canada or the US, they don't know me. They may know this song. So it's good that you start off with this one. So it's also kind of an introduction to your viewers and listeners. Do you only have viewers or you also have listeners? Viewers
yeah.
and listeners?
Both.
Yeah, okay. Both. Okay. Oh, that's even more exciting. Okay. I started off just a short summary of where I came from. So having traveled, you know, following my father around the globe, my mother could never find him, so we had to go from. It's literally true, you know. We tried to. So we went in South Africa, for instance. We went to, I think, 6 different schools because we were always chasing the guy who was gone with the secretary. So that's my youth, going from city to city and from town to town, and in South Africa, in Germany, and in Holland. So, but then eventually we landed in Holland, and when I was 16, and I had a duo with my brother Ferdy, who was 15 at the time, and we had our first hit then. And from then on, we decided, okay, music. We never said aloud, let's make music our career, but we just did it, and we left school, and in those days it was still quite kind of looked frowned upon if you leave school before, you know, and maybe even now. So we just. Got going, and we had 4 or 5 hit singles, and it started to wane a bit, and then we thought, okay, we have to do something else, and so we started writing for other people and trying to get our songs, because we wrote a massive amount of songs, and we were only allowed to release one every, you know, so few months, you know.
Wow.
So and then in the late 80s and beginning of late 70s and beginning of the 80s, there was, but I'll get to that later, because it's not out of vanity, maybe also, but it's not that I put a couple of my own songs in there, but to let the viewer listener know who you're talking to, you know. And they can make up their minds if they think it's shit or even shittier. So, okay, this song. There's a yearly a music convention in Mide in Cannes in France, called the Midem, and I was asked at the Midem by a guy who had Falco under his wing he did the A&R for him, so the artist Falco existed already. He had a European hit with De Commissar, and De Commissar was done by After the Fire, I think, in English, and was also a hit in the States and Canada. So he came to me and he said, well, what do you think? I've got the artist Falco, and he had hit with the Commissar. I said, I love the Commissar, which is one of my favorite records. Because I also lived in Germany, so I had this thing of, okay, combining German and English was something I already intended to do, but not. So I got this, and then I went home. So that was on a Wednesday. I went home on a Thursday and went straight to the movies. A theater, and I saw the movie Amadeus. It's so easy. So I saw the movie Amadeus by Milos Forman, I thought it was great, but I thought, sitting there, I thought, well, there's a crazy guy, you know, there on the silver screen, and a crazy guy, which I just got the kind of a mission to look for a song for him. So I thought, this is too easy. Falco is also crazy. So I combined the two, and the next day I wrote Rock Me Amadeus.
Wow.
And then I made a demo, and then I sent it to Horstborg, that is the guy who managed him then, and to Falco. And the reaction I got back was, no, can I say the F word?
Yeah.
No fucking way, you know, because he said, this is, are you crazy? Do you think Falco says this? Because he's from Vienna in Austria. He said, you don't, are you serious? Do you think I will sing a song about Amadeus, about Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart? But and I will be rolling, you have these, if anybody has ever been to Vienna, you see these chocolate balls, they're called Mozartkugeln, and you can buy them in any second store there, you know, it's all over the place. And he said, I will not be rolling through the streets of Vienna as a Mozart ball, you know, like a Mozart ball. So that was that. So he had rejected the song. And eventually, a month later, we convinced him, more or less forced him to, with his manager, to try and record the song. And that was the version which came out in Europe. And later I made a remix. And then other elements were in the American and Canadian version.
So what did he think when the song started climbing the charts? Did he start believing you more?
Well, that's interesting. When it was in Germany and in Europe, because it was a hit all over Europe, he thought that was okay, because he could tour more, you know, more with more elaborate designs and the stage designs and musicians. And but when it came to the U.S., which was it was in the beginning, in the first quarter of the next year, because it was turned down three times by radio, and they said so at one time Radio and Records, that was a magazine in you had that trade magazine in the U.S.
Oh.
And they had A&M, which was the label which it was on, and Jerry Moss personally, you know, the M of A&M, personally took out an ad. He said, this has got to succeed. I'll take out an ad in Radio Records, and the ad was as follows: stop the killing of innocent German dance records. And I thought that was great. And after that, he got the new version with things and new stuff into it, and which was the American hit. And when it was in the American, when he hit number one in America, he said he had a breakdown. He said, "Well, this is, my career is over now." So we thought, this is the happiest time of my life, anyway. You know, and it should be also that.
For
but
you
he
too.
Said, no, this, but he said, no, it's only, you know, he was a real optimist. He said, it's only going downhill from here. So downhill. So that was his real thought, his real emotion at that time. And he just left the party and I don't know, he cried somewhere, I think. You know, but not tears, tears of joy, but yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing. So you would think that he'd be so excited about that.
You
did
would.
He think that he couldn't top it, do you think? Like, I'm not going to be able to
that's
top
what he said.
This song?
Yeah, that's what he said. And he also recognized, of course, that I love novelty songs. You know, I love,
yeah.
That's why, well, we'll get to another song maybe. I love pop songs, which are, you know, I love or have this more or less. I love natural. I mean, a playing band, bands playing. I love that as well. But also this side where people say, well, it's too commercial, or, you know, like Sugar Sugar, or
yeah,
those kind of songs.
Yeah.
So or Yummy 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 or whatever. And I thought Rock Me Amadeus was in this category. And if you see where it's being used in, as you said, you know, like in The Simpsons, it's then they have the special Dr. Zaius, you know, that's incredibly funny, I think. But there was also in Family Guy. Okay, well, we get to that maybe because the last years I've been ill, but working, and they had this great thing in Family Guy, which said you saw this little thing on lying on the floor, and it sang, "I'm a tumor, I'm a tumor." So I'm a tumor, I'm a tumor. I thought that was very fitting for the occasion. So, okay, but that's...
So it sounds
I'm
like...
I'm talking too much, yeah.
That's okay, I like that you talk a lot. So now you create this song, he becomes a hit, you're loving it, and then years and years and years go by, and now you're creating this Rock Me Amadeus musical now.
Exactly. Yeah, there have been musicals about Falco in Europe before, predominantly in Germany and in Austria. But this is a very big musical. It's got the massive, the most people on stage you can, which was allowed, and massive musical arrangements. Rock Me Amadeus sounds extremely good in this new set up and arrangement and costumes, the song, I mean, and it's about his life. It's about the life of Falco, which, because he was a real, you can't imagine it. I can't imagine it even in Holland, because people in Holland don't even know what happened in Austria. But at the time he died, Falco died when he collided with a bus in the Dominican Republic. That's 5 a.m. or 6 a.m, I think. There was a huge funeral in Vienna with 10,000 people, and it was live transmission on the television, and you know, it was treated like royalty there. You know, it was and so that is why this musical also has this massive, because in this form for people living in Austria, but also Germany, it will also go to Germany and to, I think, Bulgaria and China, even South Korea. So there's a lot of interest in the musical. Yeah.
Is this something that you thought of long time ago that you wanted to do, and now it's coming into fruition, or was it just like how you wrote the song, like get up one day, we're gonna do this. This is what we're gonna do.
A good question, because the other musicals I mentioned, which were also about Falco, also there was also a movie, but they never took Rock Me Amadeus as the title. It was always Das Falco musical, you know, the Falco musical, or Falco meets Amadeus, which is also a very lame title, I think. But this is called Rock Me Amadeus, and that's exactly, you know, as I pictured it, you know, already when I. Well, not when I wrote it, but after it became a hit, I thought, well, that's a great title to put on a great thing title. Or whatever. And but the guys who actually I pitched this idea years ago to a guy of the company which eventually started this whole musical and wrote the musical, and then I was called in, as well as my brother. We were called in to as creative consultants. That was our title, but actually it was, in practice, it was us being there, you know, for a long time and saying this and this, and he would never do that. But this song sounds more, you know, all kinds of directions we could give. So I was very satisfied with what we could do there and the end result.
How do you, I'm always like curious, because obviously being a writer, like, did you just see it? Like, how do you see something and then get like, you know, 900 people to like create that for you? Like, are you a perfectionist? Are you like, no, hey, I need more velvet. This isn't going to work. Are you that kind of?
Yeah. I am that kind of person. but that's mostly in studio. Apart from the fact that I also want to be involved in the video, but okay, I have a certain opinion, and I'm not afraid to tell when it's about a song or when it's about production. I'm very strict and very driven. But in this case, you know, because there is a different person writes, actually two German people wrote this musical for an Austrian guy. So that's or one wrote it and the other directed it. But they were welcoming every idea that I had, and every so that was very and also using a lot of the stuff.
Yeah.
So that was nice and more than nice. It was very energy draining. But the nice thing I forget to mention is that because it has been this. It's over this amount of time between when it first came out, the song, and now being a musical, is that when I was still working with Falco, my son was born, and he Falco was recording with me at the time, and he came to the hospital. My son was a day old. He didn't even have his eyes open, and so but then he had he was in full gear, in full Falco gear with the sunglasses. So he was, you know, trying to be the star entering the hospital. But in Holland, he wasn't that famous. So nobody gave it, you know, gave a shit about who's this guy, you know. But okay, let him into. But he took with him for my son Justin a lederhosen, you know, a tiny lederhosen,
oh,
you know, which was very. Yeah, and I thought that was very sweet. So he still has the lederhosen, and now this guy, you know, he took the lederhosen, who he brought the lederhosen for, actually composed two of the songs for this musical with me, two new songs.
Wow.
Very nice. So it says, my name is Rob, and my last name Bolland, and it's Rob Bolland and Justin Dylan Bolland.
Aww.
So that's, you know... That's a nice.
That is nice.
Yeah.
So now, are you going to come into North America with this musical? Do you think?
I don't think so. I think for that it has to be. It has the grandiosity.
Potential.
I don't know if of a real musical. You know, musical. I might have seen earlier on the West End or. In the West End or on Broadway, but it doesn't. But of course, the subject matter is too limited for America to do it there. But I think, you know, if it goes to China and people or Japan also is interested, and Germany, that's a huge. I would be very pleased. But I'm pleased as it is. You know,
yeah.
As it is now.
You're proud of. Like kind of seeing your vision and then it coming to fruition. Like, is it everything that you wanted it to be?
It is. It is, and also parts of it, I must say, my brother and I are even depicted in the musical. You know, so you see two guys standing there, because my brother and I worked with him separately, but for him. So
yeah.
my brother produced, so I wrote Rock Me Amadeus. He wrote, for instance, Coming Home, which was a big hit in Germany and in German-speaking countries. And I wrote Vienna Calling, and he wrote, you know, so it was, but having seen, looking at yourself, looking absolutely different from the way you looked at back then, but they had these two leather jackets on, and they said, well, we're going to produce Falco, you know, like with a Dutch accent, you know, which I didn't recognize myself in at all. So, but the fact that we're in the musical, you know, depicted there was also very, that's one of the, even, I mean, I have to laugh when I see that, of course, but I found it very, Well, maybe strange that everybody laughs at that point, you know. Yes, but it's like we're going to pick you up and make, you know, and because the reason for the whole request, you know, to us to produce Falco came because he had an album which had sold enormously in. Before that, and they said, "Well, it's either dismiss tear up the contract, or you get different producers." So there was this new thing, and it worked. So.
I love it. I love that story. All right, next song. Travis Scott, Modern Jam.
Yeah. And already the beat was very enticing, and you know, I've taken the beat, and I'm as I've said, maybe I'm working together with my son now, who's also doing some engineering stuff for me, and I let him put the beat on the loop, and already without, you know, Travis Scott. Coming in, but I think it's a great record. That's all I can say. And also, yeah.
Oh, I was going to say, what was it like working with your brother? Like, you've worked with your brother your whole life.
That's true. I've worked with my brother, but that's exactly the reason. I mean, well, I mean, he's 18 months younger than I am, so. So when he was born, I thought, okay, who's that, you know? I had to get him to school when we were young and do this for my brother's name is Ferdy, do this for Ferdy and take him there and take him there. So that was the relationship that we had. Oh, okay, we had each other as friends and as only friends because we moved a lot.
Yeah.
So that was the reason why we stuck together very, very. But then he, when he was 15, he didn't marry her, but eventually he did. But with a famous girl singer in Netherlands, in Holland, Sander Reimer, and he moved out and left me alone with my mother, oh. and I didn't appreciate that much. But and since then we've worked apart, except for one song, and which was a hit in a very big hit in Germany, in a very controversial song, Genie by Falco. Okay, but apart from that, we've always done things separately. So now we're always in these phases. Of not talking to each other, talking to each other. After now, we're in a phase of actually not talking to each other. So there was also at the premiere of this musical, which you referred to. Yeah, there was a line, you know, at the end, you have to everybody bows, and so I my son stood next to me because he's co-composer of the 2 year song. And my brother said, at the far end, you know, absolutely as far as you can get from me, and that basically, you know, represents how we feel about each other now. So it's
that's crazy. Yeah. Was your, like, when you were growing up, did your mom listen to a lot of music? Like, where did this writing, like, what kind of music did your mom listen to when you were growing up?
Yeah, all kinds of music, but especially Frank Sinatra. And also pop songs, she would say, you had this song, the Corgis, everybody's going to learn sometime. She always said, the song with the heart, you know, that, and we when he was still at home, my brother and I would sit in the kitchen and play every song she wanted, you know?
Yeah.
So then some of our own songs, it developed out of that. So yeah. She was really the you know, and she didn't say you have to get famous, be famous, or, but she was like, everything you do is wonderful, you know.
Oh, good. So she encouraged you a lot.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so she's very, very, very pivotal in that sense that she didn't try to, say, well, you have to get a real job and then, you hear these stories. None of that for her. No, she was actually the one when we got this first single out, in 1972, she was actually the one who called the producer of a television program. You only had two television
Patients.
stations, thank you, in Holland at that time. And she called the producer, and this show was the most viewed, and it was a kind of a talk show. And she called the director, and she said, "Ah, my two sons have made a record." And okay, so 3 days later, we're in the show, and that made, that was the kickstart to our career. So
Wow.
That's
You
nice.
remember like the first time you heard your song on the radio? Do you remember like where you were? What was
At home, and it was, and wasn't played by, and that was to be, that was the blueprint for what happened afterwards. We heard it on Radio North Sea. That you had between Holland and England, there were ships lying there, and they were transmitting, some to England and some to Holland. And we heard on Radio North Sea, okay, also one of the ships lying there. And but on the English, with English DJ, so the transmission was geared towards England. And that's the first time we heard the song. And it was to be, we were never appreciated in Holland the way we were in other countries, because our only number one was, we had a massive amount of number ones in other countries in Europe, but not in Holland, so but that was actually very good, because the non-acceptance, in Holland meant that we had to look outside of Holland to make a living. That's the most elementary, basic thing,
So did they call you and say, "Hey, your song is going to be on the radio at 3:30?" Do they do that, or you have no
No,
idea?
we were just no, we knew that it was delivered to them, and they were not negative about the promoter had given it, and so we were waiting every evening, and then one evening it came on. So that's a moment you won't forget. Also, also hearing the other moments, which was which I already talked about, was the number one when we heard that Rock Me Amadeus were going to be going from four in Billboard to number one. So that was a massive, massive party. It's a
Did
massive
you
moment.
buy your mom anything special when you so-called made it? Like, did you think, oh, if I make, or if this goes to number one, or like, I want to go and buy mom something? Did you have those kind of thoughts, or you wanted to treat somebody?
That's a nice question, because we actually got to live, we had to live off what the government, paid us, because there was no father at work. We didn't have this, I don't know, I've lost the equivalent of that in America, but it's welfare or something, which,
Same thing.
so yeah. And so it was always, okay, this and this, but we were used to that, we were used to living that way. So once we got the first hit, we were, especially from performing live, we got more money than we, was, and for us it was, and then it became even more and more, with a lot of ups and downs, like every artist has, or most people. But eventually, but the first part is very crucial, because that made us go from welfare, let's say, to getting to do things. And we were also, in that first phase of our career. They wanted to make Elektra had wanted to get us the label Elektra.
Yeah.
They wanted to get us the American side. They said, "Well, come to the convention in we have a convention of WEA artists that had this Christmas combination," and it was and I think Carly Simon was the D there, and so this was a real good a real thing, and also the heads of certain labels would be there. And they said, "Well, come," but we never went anywhere. From the moment on that we got these invitations, that was to London, and it was a very nice setup, big hotel rooms, and each. But also my mom. So we took our mom everywhere. We went to Japan with her. We went to she was very she had her hands were like this. From rheumatism. I don't know if you know.
Yeah.
If that's, yeah. Okay. Arthritis, I think. And so she couldn't really do anything more, anything else, or do anything anymore with her hands. But she was eager to fly and to go to Japan and wherever, you know. She went to Yugoslavia with us for a song festival for whatever. You know, so that was nice, and that's something which we could give her, and we still remained in that same small flat in the apartment in The Hague in Holland, because we actually liked it there, and we were so, I was so much, you know, I wasn't out of it then, but later. So that was very nice, and until her death, we could maintain her, could get her into a better place to live, but she always lived not more than I think 10 minutes away from where I was, you know, so we could always
I love that. Yeah, I think that's cool, because a lot of people, when they kind of hit that stardom, you know, they always think me, like, you know. And then it's really nice to give back. I'm a big believer in giving back. So I love that you
took
your mom all over the place, and she got to see kind of, you know, most of the world, which is really cool to be able to do. And then she probably felt so proud, like watching you guys, and, you know, like it would be weird. Like, you know, you're a father and I'm a mother, and, you know, you watch your son and all these people, and you're probably just like, this is so crazy. Like, this is really cool to watch. You know, look
exactly.
At what is. Yeah, that would be.
That's what I'm experiencing now. Exactly that. But when you ask me that question, what did you give her something? The most would say, yeah, she got the car she always wanted, but she couldn't drive, of course. But I'm just disclaimer here, because okay, she could have gotten the car, but she couldn't drive. So
yeah.
She never got the Bentley or whatever. Yeah.
All right, next song.
Yeah, the first step. Yeah.
So what a beautiful song.
Yeah. Did you know it already?
I've never heard of it. No.
Oh, okay.
It's beautiful.
Okay. It's by Handel. It was used in the movie Barry Lyndon, Stanley Kubrick's movie, and that's where I first heard it. And it's used as a kind of a theme, you know, throughout the movie. But when I first heard it, I was so impressed, you know, and sitting in the theater. And I didn't write a song about that, but this was so impressive. That's why I put it on my list, because it's one of my favorite pieces of music. And I started, because of that, you know, looking more to classical composers and seeing what they did and, you know, getting to know them. But Handel is one of my favorites, and this piece in particular.
Yeah, you know. It's beautiful. So obviously, I'm assuming you've been to lots of concerts, seen lots of artists. Who has been like a what was your very first concert that you went to?
Good question. I didn't prepare this one. That was in The Hague, where I lived then. It was the Bee Gees.
Oh, wow.
And they were, and they were still in their period before, because this is in the 70s I'm talking about. And they were playing in the Hotel Sala, the venue that doesn't exist anymore. But they performed, this was really special, I mean, in hindsight, with a full orchestra, because they had these, you know, I've got to get a message to you, you know, these orchestral arrangements, you know, and they wanted to do that, to duplicate that on stage, and they managed to do that. So I was so impressed by that. Yeah.
Do you have
Sorry, go on. No. I wanted, because I mentioned my son, or you mentioned earlier, the first concert my son went to, that was in Rotterdam, and he, I got him a hat, and he put it on, and he was about, I don't know, must have been 6, 5, I don't know, maybe, because I had him on my shoulders, I know, for the whole concert, so it wasn't that old, but it was Garth Brooks, So I thought the first concert, and he's still a fan, you know, because of it, and it's also a nice reference, because he didn't venture into country for as a music, but that's made him, but that also it was such an experience with the, you know, Garth Brooks at his peak, you know, it was, so I just wanted to mention it. Yeah.
I like it. I think. And I don't know this, correct me if I'm wrong, but when I listen to music, I may not know everything about the artist or all of that kind of stuff, but what I pick out is just parts of the songs that I'm like, oh, that was really cool that they put that in there. That was really cool that they did that. When you listen to music or you see an artist, are you more not really worried about the song, but how they kind of placed everything together? Like, do you listen to music like that, or do you just hear the song?
Yeah, it's a good question, because I sometimes, if I like a song very much, and I try not to duplicate it, but putting my own twist to it, you know, then you say, well, what makes this song so special? You know, I had this with the Glass Animals, the song. I can't remember the title, but it, you can hear the song over and over again, and not being able to determine what makes this song. You know, I mean, a song like As It Was by Harry Styles, for instance. You know, you see this song in the charts; it's there forever. You know, and you have this with Just Another Day, John Cicada. It was also a very long, a very long run in the Billboard Hot 100. And that's a song which I can't put my finger on where the verse starts and the chorus ends, and I think that's really brilliant. And he could only do it once, of course. So I'm not also Gautier, you know, the Gautier, the song again. I saw my list.
Good.
Let me see.
Do you remember the first like cassette or LP you ever bought, like with your own money?
Yep. It was Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. The first single I bought was in South Africa, was Tired of Waiting by the Kinks. So this is for the older listeners. And it was because it had. I was motivated also. I loved the song and the record, but my father used to promise to come, every other Sunday. So I waited on a specific point where I could see, you know, in where the car was coming from, if he would arrive. And sometimes I sat the whole Sunday there and he wouldn't come. Okay, well, that's it. So it was kind of a kind of a let's say treatment for me, or kind of a it made it more more of an experience which I could handle, you know, because it was, I couldn't understand why he would promise something and not. So with his record, every time I listen to his record, every time I hear it again, I just think back to that moment. You know,
So did you ever connect with your father later on, or were you constantly just chasing him?
Okay, well, that's also a good question, because when I told you about, okay, this is a short answer. When we got the contract and we released the first single in Holland,
we didn't
know where he was, you know. So all of a sudden he calls and comes by. So he was in Holland all the time, but he comes by and says, okay, from now on I'm your manager. Okay, so we, you know, so the second single is released shortly after, and then we are allowed to make an album. And he's the manager now, all of a sudden, you know, which gave him a certain stature, you know, sort of this. And then we didn't have our, because we were in Holland, you have to be 18 to drive. So we both didn't have our driver's license yet. So he would drive us to a meeting with an arranger for the songs that we had written. So we went from The Hague to Hilversum, which is in the middle of Holland. And when we arrived in Hilversum, there's a slight bend in the road there where you can park the car. So he parked the car there, and he was, I mean, apart from being like an asshole, you know, I mean, not acknowledging us just and only when there's something to gain. He was always, but what I liked him for was that he was a very humoristic guy. He had a good sense of humor with good jokes, remarks. And so that's the side I liked about him. And then he started in the car. So he parked the car. My brother's sitting in front, I'm sitting in the back, and he goes like, and we start laughing, of course, because we think, well, that's him doing his thing again, you know, and this is a different way, but okay, and then all of a sudden was nothing, and that was how he died. So I ran to the hospital, which was nearby. My brother stayed with him. And they pronounced him dead in the hospital, but he was already dead in the car. So I think there's a sort of a thing woven in here, you know, where you can be too. I'm not. This is not a right word, but you can be too. You know, taking advantage of a certain situation and getting. You know, I didn't think that when he was. When we buried him, but there is this, you know, it's not the way to treat your wife and your children, you know.
No,
the way
it's like it karma happened really fast for him.
Karma, thank you. That's the word I was looking for. Come on, interrupt me. yeah, please do.
I love it.
I'm floating off.
I love it. That's so crazy. What a crazy story.
It is. It's a crazy story. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. All right, next song.
One of my favorites.
Remember when you ran away and I got on my knees and begged you not to leave because I go berserk? Well, you left me in.
They come to take me away. Jeez, I haven't heard that song in a long time. That's awesome.
I that's one of my all-time favorite records. But two things. I loved it when it came out. I love it now, and I love it when I die or when I'm dead, because I will have this played at my funeral. Those are things. But also because later I thought, okay, what are they doing? They just have this drum pattern. They have this voice, which they speed up at the end, and there's actually no instruments. There is a chorus that comes in way high. But it's all just it's one of the first rap records, you know. I mean, it's not in time, but it's been in time. So that's, I think, with the limitations of what they used, and the enormous hit it became, because it was so witty. So I have a great respect for the man who did that. Yeah,
it's such a creative song. Is there, obviously you're a movie buff, you like lots of movies. Is there a soundtrack to a movie that you absolutely love?
I mean Stanley Kubrick uses music really well, Tar, I think, a movie with Kate Blanchett. I love the soundtrack to that, but it would have to be American Graffiti, for instance, which I wasn't part of the 50s, and that movie made me, you know, me and a lot of other people, you know, love the 50s music. But also, when a song, you know, like in Almost Famous, where the whole bus starts singing, Tiny Dancer. And that's such a moment, and you think, whoa, and this wasn't a hit at the time, but I'm always thinking about what it, you know, is it okay, I get it, if it was number one. No, but this wasn't the song which was, you know, and that's Cameron Crowe, who's so good at that, you know, using, and that's, and some of the, some of the times that my music has been used in movies, sometimes better than other times. But listening to, especially classical music, the use of that, and minimal music also. I love that as well in movies, like Spanish Fussy. I was really blown away by it. You know, I saw it in London, and I thought, you know, without drugs or whatever, but I felt like I had taken whatever, you know.
I love that you said Tiny Dancer, because I remember that movie because of that song. You know, that song, when they sang that song, it was almost like, I don't know what happened. It was like, we've seen that movie, haven't heard that song for a long time, then listened to that song. Then that song, anytime we were around our friends, we played it and we'd all sing it. And then we were on a catamaran for our wedding, and it was dead quiet. Like, it was dead quiet. This song comes on, and it was just like the whole entire wedding that was on the catamaran just enjoyed the ocean, and we all sang that song. I was just like,
good story.
But it's one of those songs that it's like people know it, and it's like we can just sing it together, you know, friends, whatever's going on in our life. I love music like that. That's why I love music. But I think it's so powerful that you can do that to people.
Yeah. Your wedding was on a catamaran. That's how you pronounce it.
The next day we went after the wedding. We took the wedding party, everybody out on a catamaran the next day, and we were listening to music. But it was just all of a sudden, it was just dead quiet, and then that song came on, and it was just like, I don't know, it was just so peaceful to have everybody sing that song together. Like, it was just, I don't know, it was like, it was crazy. Like, it was just a feeling like, oh my God, we're all, you know, 35 people are all singing this song together. We're all friends, we're all together. And this is just a song that everybody knows, and we can belt it out. I just thought that was such, it's so crazy that music can do that. I like Quentin Tarantino for that too. Like, the music that he puts in his movies are a lot of the music I've never, ever heard before. And I'm like, his taste must be like a collective all over the place, that I love watching his movies just because I want to know what kind of music he's going to put in the Move.
Very good. Yeah. That's true. Also, I have this. Okay, I have this same feeling. Well, I have two things about say about Quentin. Which was safer? So the first thing, which when you mentioned Quentin Tarantino, I'm sorry, was that the George Baker song. Little Green Bag.
Green Bag, yeah.
Yeah. So Little Green Bag is I know this guy, you know, Hans Bauer, George Baker, and it was a hit, not a massive hit in America. So it's also one of those things that he had latched on but this guy he's now in his 80s and he's almost and he's working just on the back of that song. He got this whole new lease on life, you know, in Holland. Yeah, absolutely. And I also worked with Dick Dale for a session. And Dick Dale is a guy who's also who he does the intro to Pulp Fiction. I mean, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but in the last Tarantino movie, there's one song which did the same for me. Well, not quite the same, but on a different level, which I kept on listening to, which was, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. It was 12:30 by Mamas and Papas. You know, where when there's this young girls are coming to the canyon. You know, you feel this. You feel this vibe. I mean, I've been to LA a couple of times, but when I hear that song, I see it in front of me. You know, the whole Laurel Canyon stuff. You know, yeah.
Yeah, I love that music can do that. All right, next song. Old Turkey.
Yeah, fantastic. This is one of my, well, that's why it's on the list. Awesome favorite. Okay, John Lennon at his best, I think. Clapton on guitar at his best, I think, because it's raw and not he became a bit milder as the years went along. Also good, but not this.
Yeah.
Ringo Starr on drums. Great, a great drummer, I think, because people tend to, you know, disregard his well, as a functional and as a great drive, that's also in this. And so on four musicians, and the other one, Klaus Voormann, he is on the bass, and I actually met Klaus Voormann, let's say 15 years ago or something. But I was so in awe of him at first. I said, "Mr. Foreman." Klaus, you speak German. I'm German. It's like, oh yeah, of course you're German. You know, but he's worked with Manfred Mann. He's worked with the Plastic Ono Band. He's worked with at the concert of Bangladesh. He's Carly Simon. You know, at the beginning of You're So Vain. And so I've just listened all evening. I listened to his stories, and he actually that was one of the best things you can get. You get a lot of money writing a song which goes to one number one in the States, but getting this. It eclipses that, because he said, well, you know, what you've done with Falco, you know, I mean, I'm German and I know what he said about this song and that song. And so he knew the albums, and that was, you know, my stuff, you know, I mean,
yeah,
I'm so, yeah, and that's a great moment. So he's on the track as well. And I love the track. Yeah.
Were you more of a Beatles fan or more of a Rolling Stones fan?
Well, actually, in the beginning, both, because I loved the album, the Stones album we played continuously when we were in, you know, I told you about this up and down journey throughout South Africa and everything following. So once we were all in a trailer park, you know, and we had just a tiny record player. And one of the two records I think we had was Stones, Out of Our Head. And we played that, you know, because it was the only record we had. But great. But also in South Africa, I remember, because it's one of those moments, I was on the beach and then we lived in a hotel in a very, so we were like from there to there and going back. And so that was a very nice hotel and we had to dress up for the evening every time. But I heard this from the hotel, which was up on the, I was on the beach and the hotel was up there. But then I heard the sound and it turned out to be, I Want to Hold Your Hand. And I thought, I've never heard anything like this before. You know, so from that moment on, I was a Beatles fan. And at a certain point, I had a collection with, when I got the revenues from the Falco stuff, but also from another song, You're in the Army Now, which I wrote, which became a massive hit in a lot of countries. So I had enough money to go to London, let's say weekly, and go to the Sotheby's auction or to the Christie's or, you know, Bonham's, and buy Beatles stuff, which I wasn't able to buy when I was younger. You know, it's a classic thing, you know. Then I got rid of it again later. But there was also a letter, if you're into Beatles things, and you had this court case where George Harrison had the song My Sweet Lord. And then he got the court case from the writer of He's So Fine, or the writers of He's So Fine by the Chiffons, claiming that he had stolen the melody, and in fact it was true. But they had, this was our court case, and in the end, they got 50% of the. I don't know how much what it turned out to be, but I saw in this, I bought a letter which George wrote to a fan when it was in 1964, and I saw it in the catalog, and I thought, I have my magnifying glass, and so he had his top three or his top five. You have the top ten. He had his top five records listed there, and at four it was "He's So Fine" by the Chiffons. So I thought, this is kind of a, you know, detective work, and then I sold it for much more than I bought it for that particular reason. So that's nice. Yeah,
that's interesting because I just finished reading Keith Richards' memoirs, I guess you would call them.
Yeah.
Great book. But in there, it was kind of interesting because he said, obviously, when they were becoming famous and the Beatles were coming famous, they actually like had conversations with each other and said, we're going to release this song, so don't release a song this week. Then you release the next song next week, which is really cool. You wouldn't think that they would have conversation like that. But they were like, you know, helping each other out to become successful instead of like bashing heads, which I'm sure they probably did too, but to be able to help each other and to also have that kind of control, monopolize the, you know, kind of the industry, right? Hey, you put out a record, you know, you put out a song, I'm going to put out a song.
That's unique.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think you could find that in today's day and age, right? I think
no, and the whole cultural thing that they also created, you know, it's really remarkable looking back on it, because what artist would that do? Would that be now?
I don't know.
No. I mean, Variety called the growth of. And also Taylor Swift, a cultural phenomenon, just recently.
Yeah.
But I went to see the movie but I had in the back of my mind, you know, on Instagram you have these things coming, stories coming,
like June to June.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm not good at that. But at naming. Thank you for your help. But there, you see Aretha Franklin saying, a reporter asking, okay, Aretha, what do you think about, and it's Celine Dion, well, she's got a great voice, you know, what do you think about Amy Winehouse? Yeah, I really like her. And what do you think about Taylor Swift? Well, she's beautiful dresses, you know, so that's how I went into the movie. And I couldn't get that out of my head, looking at the movie, which is very long, but it's very impressive on the big screen, and it grosses enormously, in the U.S. and I think maybe Canada too.
Yeah.
So and here too. What I respect most of all is her savvy on the business side and doing what she did with the albums. But that would be as close to a cultural phenomenon as it would get nowadays, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know.
Yeah, you
but,
don't
but
you, see it
but
very
you're right.
Much. Yeah.
No. But I'm not one of those people who still just lives in the 50s or in the 60s or in the 70s. You know, I hope to be a person who has moved on, but still has this like you point out, you know, this reverence for what happened then, you know.
Yeah. Right, next song. Three.
Yeah, I don't know if your listeners are into Born Free. I don't think so, but I'm very much into Born Free because the composer John Barry. Also the composer of many movie soundtracks, but especially his James Bond association. He did the best Bond songs, and this is also sung by one of my favorite vocalists, Matt Monro, who was a friend of John Barry's and who was like the UK answer to Frank Sinatra. But it's more than that for me. This is also part of my stay in South Africa as a kid, and not even I can't even recall watching the movie, going to this movie. But this song has always and has always given me like a bit of old fashioned feeling, like Born Free, you can do anything, you know, like that.
Yeah. Do you have somebody, have you had somebody your whole life, like, encouraging you to write? Like, have you had kind of those mentors in your life? Or are you just driven and you're just going to go and do it?
Well, that's a good question. The thing is that my drive for writing, my brother wrote, let's say, not as many, but I don't think as many, no, but it was not his say you can do better or do the competition. That's what made between my brother and myself. Yeah. That's what drove
me. You wanted to win.
and he wanted to win. And he wanted to, you know, how's the next thing? How's the next thing? And I don't want to put myself up there with the great ones, but then I read about it and I thought, well, this is exactly how we got a lot we learned a lot from McCarthy and Lennon and McCarthy has to do it the right way around because also with like with okay we it's always said the label always said Bolland and Bolland, you know, so that was our name and that was our chosen name, but if the credits read, you know, if it was one of my songs and the credits read Birdie and Rob Bollan, I would go, you know, go straight to the and
yeah,
say, well, let's not do
that.
change. So, but in this case with now, I do have someone who is firing me on and who is getting the, you know, getting the last drop of energy out of me. That's my son. and Justin Dillon, and that's exactly the way how we co-composed the two songs for the Falco musical, but also the way we are now in contact with other styles of music. On the back of well my resurrection, so to speak. I've been out of the not been working for let's say 6 or 7 years because of when cancer struck me. So going through this whole thing with operations and with the radiation stuff and the chemos, I have not been able to work. I was just either in the hospital or in a black room, in the dark room.
Yeah.
So now that I'm out of the dark room, but still on the clock, and they're not going to do anything anymore because that's where they've done everything. So it also gives me the freedom to do, you know, to do stuff which I've never done before, and that's where he comes in. So he's already got lined up about 5 productions with dance producers, which we are going to do vocal stuff for.
Wow.
He's also going to other. So this is also he said, well, if you speak to him, make sure you mention it, because you never know who might be watching. And I'm open to we're open because we work together now on this particular moment in time. So we would like to work with anybody who wants a pop song or whatever. And he's going to, well, as I said in an interview the other day for a Dutch paper, and had the headline. He's squeezing the last drop of energy out of me, and that's exactly what he's doing, you know. So I said, you know, can I do this? Can I do this interview with you in it? You know, and not can I do it physically or whatever, do it. That's it's a good, you know, do anything, and it's also it's something you have never done before. Well, talk to you. And you have a special way of coercing things, you know, out of people, and that's why my answers are so long. So you have to cut me off sooner. Yeah.
Well, I think we should interview Justin as well. I think that would be fun too.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
That would be fun.
Yeah, let him know.
Yeah, because he's less chaotic than me, and he can. Yeah. but that's a good idea.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
All right, next song.
Yeah.
All right, some more
specific
stats, right?
I'm sorry.
That's okay. I was just saying some more string quartets, and I think it's awesome. I love like where your brain goes with this kind of stuff, right? And then you can go.
Yeah.
Sounds like you really love this type of music, but then you go and produce amazing pop songs. So it's so, it's wild to me. Like it's
wild. Yeah. I'm still looking to produce the perfect pop song. That is the main quest. But you're right. You're right. I love your these other things to go to. But for instance, I use that with the sound here, with all the samples, with the cut up conversations and in a musical context. So like with Falco, just getting back to something which people might know or someone's granddad might have heard, you know, in the 80s, which is Vienna Calling, which was a single in the US and it was a worldwide single, but it was the top 20 in the US on the back of Rock Me Amadeus. And I had this, it was a time where people made or musician made or producers made a lot of 12-inch remixes. You know, that Frank Goes to Hollywood had about 10 or 12 of the Relax, and you know, it was remix after remix, and I loved that process because you could do the, you know, all kinds of other stuff with the song,
yeah,
which you didn't think of before. So I did that with Rock Me Amadeus, but I also did it with Vienna Calling, and then because I was in this mode of, well, what can you do with a song called Vienna Calling? So I made the Vienna Tourist version, and it has all these, so you have a guy, who, a narrator, who says, well, now we're going through to the theater where Falco is at this moment performing, and you hear people clapping, and that's the Wiener Sängerknaben, you know, it's a choir. So it's a kind of the tourist mix, and it became it sold an incredible amount of 12 inches because it was a kind of underground thing. So I was so happy to be connected to something underground, because my work is overtly pop and you know, yeah, overtly pop and not so that's it. Okay.
I like it. All right, we're gonna do another one of your songs.
Captain Hölzel and his crew, we hope you've had a pleasant flight with Austrian Airlines and that your stay in Vienna will be a pleasant one. Thank you and bye-bye.
Vienna's Calling. Another great
song. That's it. Yeah, and that's exactly the version I was talking about. So if people would continue listening, then they would hear the guy saying, oh, I'm going to be
yeah.
So that's having fun in the studio and with all these sounds and just using that, because getting the samples, you know, working with samples then in the 80s was kind of new, and that's what I love. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite 80s rock band that you like a lot?
Okay, good question. Well, it's, I think so, but I would have to
like, did you like a lot of the 80s hair bands that were,
well, I there's one which also comes up in the there was one with I remember the video mainly, but I loved a lot of the stuff which was written by Desmond Child and you know, with Bon Jovi. Well, one of my favorite singles, I must say, and which I had two moments during concerts which brought tears to my eyes when I saw them. And I wasn't a big Springsteen fan. I loved his work, but not a big. But when Hungry Heart, when he the first, you know, da, 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 when the intro came in, you know, I just started crying. And I thought it was, when I saw him live in Rotterdam, in Holland, I was so moved because it was so. And then having Mark Volman and the other guy from the Turtles doing the backing vocals, you know, on the record, that record, but also that performance of the song, that really, I was really floored by that.
Yeah. An amazing performer. Like, that's one thing I miss about concerts nowadays. I feel like they're not the same as how they were in the 80s.
Yeah.
I'm going to see Kiss, like, on the 12th, and it's not, you know, I love Kiss, but I'm really going to see the stage show. I'm really going to see, like, the pyros and them all dressed up and, like, be entertained. I feel like a lot of people just are not utilizing this stage to go and perform, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
They need to do more of that. They need to bring it all back. Right.
That's I agree.
Especially for $800 a ticket. Like, you better be jumping rope on the stage.
Yeah. It's amazing how expensive these things get, and even, you know, if it's yeah. But you're right. I think there's a directness to, and people say, well, that's retro, and but there's this kind of a punch, you know, that the show's at, and a lot of records, I'm still thinking. Okay, but well, I'll get back to that maybe. Yeah.
All right. Next song. In the Army Now, Status Quo.
Yeah. Well, this is a song which was part of a concept album which my brother and I did called Domino Theory, and it was a synth. It was also a Moog synthesizer played by someone else, played by a real maniac who had all these this gear, but it was predominantly my songs, and this is also one of my songs which was an album track, and it was this album was made in 1980, I think, and there was not a time to release concept albums, you know. That was something of the 70s, you know, with the Genesis and with the costumes and with whatever, you know, the prog rock thing, and but still, so I released we released this, and this song was in our version, in this version which is on this record, it was a hit. It was major in Scandinavia. It was a gold, platinum, 5 weeks number one in Sweden or Norway, and also Greece and Italy a bit. But when 5 years later, an English band called Status Quo, who had one American hit, I think, Pictures of Matchstick Men in the 60s, but their style was they've had the most top 40 hits in Britain, in Great Britain, of all ever. So they were very they were very big, and they chose to do this song in their way, but it was very close to the original, and that was a massive hit. That was a massive hit all over Europe. In Russia, in Israel, everywhere except the U.S. and Canada, and because I think I don't think that A&M, the company, the record company which had bought this for securities for the U.S. and some other territories, it was the subject matter, of course, because I wrote this first song. That was the first song I wrote for this album, and it was also I wrote this after seeing Apocalypse Now by Francis Coppola. So Apocalypse Now blew me away. I've seen that movie I don't know how many times, but the first time I saw it, it was so. Also, there the use of music is very very important. Of record, you know, melodies from that period where they were in, yeah. So, but I thought that was a great theme to a great subject to write songs about. So that's what I did. The whole album is about, or the feeling is Apocalypse Now for me.
Yeah.
And it was so as I said, it's either Rock Me Amadeus. I think this song is in terms of revenues, it's bigger than Rock Me Amadeus for me. And people in all these countries in Russia, the band has to play twice on the evenings in Petersburg. In Israel, it's everywhere except again in the US. But I get it. So you have these two Dutch kids, Dutch white guys singing about a war which you don't know anything about. You know, and but just my love for this movie, and this movie instructed me to, you know, to go do these songs, but I get it that it won't ever float there, you know, it's just that, and I would be maybe as a as a Dutch person, you know, would be saying, well, what is a guy from, I don't know, from Mars that has to do with the Second World War? Or it's so ingrained in it has to do with all kinds of feelings which I don't know about, which I didn't feel. And so that's that. But it still got me a great song.
Yeah. What projects are you working on right now, or projects that are coming up that you would like to share to the audience?
Well, one is a musical which I'm writing with my son, Justin Dillon. And what it's about, well, I wanted to say what it's about because it's we're but it's this, you know, it is podcast, what is it, podcast?
Yeah.
We'll transcend your borders, and it will, I think. Then I don't think it's a good idea to mention the subject matter. But it's going to be great, I think. We have interest already from you know, the guys who have set up the whole business structure for the whole. So that's nice. And as I said, working with outside people now. My son has lined up for me. It doesn't mean, when I say lined up for me, it doesn't mean that I do nothing. You know, well, I personally do not. No, but he is very very well informed in all these. He does nothing but read, you know, the who's who and what. So we have these collaborations with five or six dance producers lined up, and then some other in another territory which he's now exploring. We have three things, and then I'm working on my own album, and he's working on his own album.
Wow.
And so that's yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
How do you pick which artists to sing your song?
Well, so sometimes it's like, well, just name Falco. It's that was being offered, but you don't get those instances. Well, we also wrote songs for Susie Quattro for. But they were not the hits, you know. And people know Susie Quattro better from, I think, from Happy Days, where she was at a role, than maybe in the U.S. than her hits as a singer or as an artist. We wrote a massive amount of songs for. We crossed the whole. Well, someone we turned down. Okay, well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Because I think she's from Canada. We were in such a we had a big, you know, so many artists offered to us following the success of Rock Me Amadeus and the song In the Army Now, which was released, you know, the cover version simultaneously. So once we had the three top positions in Germany with our songs, you know. So that was kind of the massiveness of what song for this, song for that. So one of the artists we turned down is Céline Dion, and so that's, you know, in hindsight you say, how is that possible? You know, it's possible because we were so busy with this and this,
yeah.
You know. So that's yeah.
Do you have some songs? I'm assuming you probably have some songs that you really want to release. Like, you really want a certain singer to sing. Do you have songs like that?
Yeah, I have one song like that, and but not really, because I want. I'm really looking for writing specifically for the moment and for an artist, and then. Because sometimes the first contract might with an artist or with the management would be in June, and you get to record, let's say, in January. Well, then the whole landscape has changed already.
Yeah.
You know, it might have changed, but a good song is a good song, okay. But still, if it's too, you know, so it you always I mean, but once I'm active again, that brings back all these. You have to do that and that, and that's the order which, and you could write for that. But so we have this whole schedule on the wall, where we have the artists in boxes, let's say, and we. Change dates or change whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So, but it's interesting because I never thought that I would be working at this level again, you know. So that's yeah. Nice.
All right, we're on your last song, and I'm gonna pick it because I think.
Are you ready to do things tonight that you never dreamed were possible?
Okay, it was the hit in Europe, but in the States it was a dance hit. And it was one of the first. It was the beginning of the house.
Is it?
But that obviously it started in the U.S. But okay. So
yeah.
what we picked up as house in Europe, and also the whole remix was done, by guys who are far more into that. But the song. And the artist was offered, so would you like to produce something for Samantha Fox? Absolutely, you know. It's a tiny story. We had to record in England, so I sent the tape over and do two songs. Then we had tapes, okay. We recorded at the Battery Studios in London, and she was there with her father. And there was a story in itself because her father was an alcoholic, and he kept on drinking with his buddy in the studio. So it was really embarrassing for her. But then she said, "Okay, now you have to leave." So that's that. So she was ready to sing, and it took a while because she's not really a singer, but she's a great person. You know, she has this. You know, she knows that she is not the best singer in the world, and so she takes she knows she has to take time, and what you hear on the record is her voice, my voice. You know, I used to sing real girlish, girly high. But she was so good. So finally we have this on tape then, on tape, and we had specifically asked to bring my own. Engineer, because I worked with him very good, and we had a good working relationship. We wanted to do this as quick as possible, or as good as possible. So then, when she was finished, she said, "Okay, let's listen to what I've just recorded." You know, so he pushes the button, and nothing comes. So, well, what's wrong? So okay, it turned out that he had erased her vocals by mistake because it was. You know, this guy that is a true artist, I think, you know. When people say, "Well, Samantha Fox, you know, she can't sing or she can, you know." Yeah, she can sing. Not as good as, you know, but what makes her good is, what made her good then was an artist, you know. And she stood there and I said, "Well, you know, you've heard it, you know, your vocals are gone, you know, and they're not coming back anytime soon." So then she said, "Well, you want me to do it again?" "Right, I'll do it." You know, and she went straight into the studio and did them again, you know, another couple of hours. So I think that's great. You know, I mean, don't go yelling at people and just think, okay, it has to be done.
Fix the problem, go solve it. Let's get out.
Great attitude. Yeah,
I love it. Well, thank you so much, Rob, for joining us on Music Junkies today. But before I let you go, I have one last question. And from all of your adversity and growing up and life, what is some words of wisdom that you would like to leave our guests today?
Okay. Oh, okay. Did we prepare this? I did bring it into
the conversation earlier, but because I'm now in so 3.5 years ago they said you have 6 months to live, so I have 3 extra years already,
So what I've learned in those years is that I was really, and I still am a bit, on top of things and have it my way. But if you can see your way, and I still have my problems as well, but it was my own brother. But okay, but I'm slashing my own advice. Try to see the end result and work around. You know, don't take that many. Don't go through loops the whole and try to get to the target sooner than you would if you would have your way in everything. And it's also a lesson. I'm talking to myself here, so I see myself in the Zoom thing. So watch it, you know. So thank you for the lesson you gave me now, because this is more and more advice that I should take. You know?
Yeah. Thank you again so much. Great words of wisdom. I agree, right? Stop focusing on where you are presently, right? Enjoy the journey, right? If you're persistent, you keep after it, it's going to lead you to what you want to go and do. So stop focusing on the negative and just focus on the outcome that you want. So great words of wisdom. Appreciate you. Like, follow, subscribe. You can stalk this
guy.
We're going to give you all your social media, right? We're going to put you out there tons, and I just want to fly there to go see Rock Me Amadeus.
If you get into Europe, let me know.
I will.
Yeah.
I love that.